I'm going to show you a total of 4 photos now. First, take a look at these two. Do you think they look similar? Now, let's take a look at these 2 photos. Did you see any similarity in these? None of these ordinary photos. For example, one, the most complex structures in nature is the human brain. This is one of the large-scale structures in the universe, the cosmic web. This is an image of a brain magnified 40 times. And this is the cosmic web. On one side, there's the human brain with 86 billion neurons and trillions of connections. And on the other side, there are billions of galaxies forming the cosmic web. They're on different scales, but they have surprisingly similar structures. So could such a similarity be just a coincidence? Or does the universe have a consciousness, just like humans do? If the universe is a conscious structure, could our consciousness be a part of it? I have crazy questions in my head. Let's try to figure this out a bit. Italian astrophysicist Franco Vazza and brain surgeon Alberto Feletti have been researching the similarity between the neural networks in the human brain and the cosmic web for a long time. These 2 photos comparing brain neurons with a virtual galaxy cluster look very similar, yes, but there's so much more in the human brain and the universe than what meets the eye. These 2 scientists investigated whether these similarities go deeper. Now take a look at the results. In both the brain and cosmic web, only 30% of the mass is made up of active components. So what does this mean? Only 30% of the mass of our brain consists of neurons. The rest is made up of water and some supporting cells. In the cosmic web, 30% consists of galaxies. In the rest, instead of water, there's dark energy. Look, even while I'm talking about it, my hair is standing on end. It's not over, I'm continuing. These 2 researchers also studied the variations in matter density within the human brain and the cosmic web. This process is called spectral analysis. I don't want to go into too much detail and confuse you, but we can roughly say this. This spectral analysis examines the different frequency components within complex structures and determines the density distributions. As a result of this analysis, similarities have been observed. So both systems are similar in terms of complex network structures and density distributions. One can't help but wonder if this is just a coincidence. It's not over. The researchers also conducted a network analysis between the brain and the cosmic web. There are surprising similarities here as well. For example, neurons in the brain are considered as nodes, and they connect with each other through synapses. The nodes of the cosmic web are galaxies. So in a way, neurons of the cosmos are them. In the brain, each neuron connects with other neurons. Galaxies connect via gravity, like synapses in the brain, with similar densities. In the brain, this connection task is taken on by synapses, while in the cosmos, gravity serves as the substitute for synapses. So, in both structures, these connections have been analyzed, and significant similarities in connection densities have been observed in terms of structural organization. What could all of this be telling us about the workings of the universe? There are very delicate balances in our brains. It's as if fine adjustment has been made at every point. Thanks to this balance, brain functions work in a healthy and efficient way. For example, a microscopic shift or damage in one area of our brain can lead to serious neurological problems. Similarly, the universe also has delicate balances. For example, the force that holds the elements together in the atomic nucleus is 0.07. If this value were 0.006 or lower, only hydrogen would exist in the universe. If it were 0.008 or higher, hydrogen atoms would quickly combine and turn into heavier elements. In either case, the conditions necessary for life wouldn't have formed. Another example, if gravity were just a bit stronger, stars would be smaller because they would form from less material, and therefore their lifespans would be shorter. For example, the lifespan of the Sun would likely be just a few thousand years instead of 10 billion years. In that case, there wouldn't be enough time for complex life to form. For example, if the mass of an electron were 2.5 times greater, only neutrons would exist in the universe. So there wouldn't be any atoms. Chemical reactions wouldn't happen either. The famous British theoretical physicist Lee Smolin has taken all this balance into account in his book The Life of the Cosmos and stated that the probability of life existing in the universe is 1 in 10 to the power of 229. Do you know what this means? Put 229 zeros next to the number 10. And that's the probability of life in the universe. 1 divided by that number. So how can we explain this fine-tuning, this delicate balance? How did the necessary conditions, life, come together? Why is the value of the force holding the elements in the atomic nucleus together? 0.007 and not 0.006. Why was the strength of gravity adjusted to be exactly what it needs to be? Scientists are focusing several theories to explain this. One of them is the multiverse theory. Could it be that our universe is designed to support life among different universes? The multiverse theory suggests that there are other universes in addition to our own. Each universe have different physical laws. Our universe might be one of the rare universes that has the conditions to support life among these universes. So maybe only a few among billions of universes, the necessary conditions for life. And it's because we can exist in such a universe that we are able to observe all of this. Another possible explanation is the anthropic principle. According to this principle, we can only exist in a universe where conditions make life possible. Our universe is fine-tuned because we can only exist in such conditions. If physical laws were different, life wouldn't be possible. We've adapted to the universe's conditions. Thus, life's existence doesn't require fine-tuning. So we have adapted the physical laws of the universe. If this approach is correct, existence of life does not require any fine-tuning. Life forms under these conditions. Life in a hydrogen-only universe seems unlikely. Such balances forming randomly seems illogical. Because the possibility of life in a universe that only has hydrogen doesn't really sit well with me. So, the idea that such delicate balances could form randomly doesn't seem very logical to me, to be honest. When we rule out this possibility, we are left face to face with the main topic of this video. The British astrophysicist Arthur Eddington presented some ideas about the nature of consciousness and matter. In his work, The Nature of the Physical World, Eddington said that what we call consciousness might be a property of matter. For example, we humans directly experience our own consciousness, right? We are also aware of our consciousness. So could the substances in our brain, which are the source of that consciousness, be conscious themselves? According to Eddington, it could be, if this theory is correct, matter in the outside world may also have consciousness. So, there is a possibility that the universe, its entire cosmos, also has a consciousness. We can't know this for sure right now, because we don't have direct access to the nature of matter outside the brain. Yes, we see them, we perceive them, but we can't directly experience them because they are not a substance inside our brain. Eddington uses the metaphor of a cable for this. So according to him, the information flowing from the physical reality of the external world to our consciousness reaches us, as if through a cable. One end of the cable is connected to our consciousness, and the other end is connected to the external world. We only directly experience the part of this cable that reaches our consciousness, so we understand the external world using the limited information we gather from here, or we think we understand. For example, a paleontologist looks at a footprint in a fossil to try to understand which animal it belongs to. Most of the time, yes. Based on its footprint, it can estimate the animal's size, shape, and even how it moved. But we can't know exactly what the animal looked like or its specific behaviors. According to Eddington, in a similar way, we also experience limited information coming from the matter in the external world. And based on this limited information, you're only making guesses about the external world. So what if we looked at the topic from a philosophical perspective? When we think deeply about the nature of consciousness and workings of the universe, a philosophical view emerges: panpsychism. It's a philosophical movement that advocates the idea that all matter contains consciousness. According to this view, consciousness is not just a feature exclusive to the human brain. On the contrary, everything in the universe, from atoms to galaxies, carries some form of consciousness. In fact, consciousness is a fundamental feature of the universe. According to panpsychism, every piece in the universe is part of a vast web of consciousness. So, our consciousness could also be a part of this universe. Is it possible to think of a drop in the ocean as separate from the ocean? Each drop is the essence of the ocean, carrying its qualities. We might also be drops within this vast ocean of consciousness. If the consciousness of the entire universe is here, inside our brains, then only one question remains. Are we a drop in the ocean, or is the ocean within the drop?